Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of God that engages us today is from Matthew chapter 13, starting in verse 31. Jesus put another parable before them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed that a man took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it has grown, it is larger than all the garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches." He told them another parable. "The kingdom of heaven is like leaven that a woman took and hid in three measures of flour till it was all leavened." The verses I just read are not part of today's gospel reading, although they should have been. After all, without this little section of scripture, you don't get all the kingdom parables that are in Matthew chapter 13. They are included in the Revised Common Lectionary used by the Roman Catholic Church and most other Protestant churches, and yet somehow they were left out of the LCMS lectionary. I joked yesterday, maybe the LCMS is gluten intolerant and didn't like this parable about yeast and flour. Small things like mustard seed and yeast have a way of slipping through the cracks and going unnoticed. But big things often come from small beginnings, and that's the point of Jesus' two parables today. I brought some mustard seed with me, but I forgot it. It's in the vestry. You'll have to take my word that it's not much to look at. It's hard to see, and proverbially, mustard seed was the smallest seed in the garden. Yet any botanist can tell you that, strictly speaking, that statement is biologically untrue. There are plenty of smaller seeds scattered across God's green earth. But mustard seed surely illustrates the point that big things come from small beginnings. From a little seed, a garden shrub as tall as 10 feet, 3 meters high, can grow, dwarfing the smaller shrubs and bushes beneath it. And that's the picture in Jesus' first parable. The second is about a woman who hid leaven, kind of a strange word there. She hid the leaven or the yeast in 3 measures of flour until the whole batch was leavened. The measures were seahs, which were about 13 liters. I know that some of you really like to bake, but I highly doubt that any of you have done as much baking as I have in my life, the one exception being Debbie Poucher, who was a baker's daughter. And she told me after a service last night, she said, "I was going to raise my hand and correct you right in the middle of your message." I'm glad she didn't. But I grew up working in the kitchen of my parents' pizzeria on the south side of Milwaukee. And from the age of 12 until 20, my sisters and I worked there every day. Rolling dough, mixing dough, topping pizzas, baking pizzas, working the fryer and the grill. I did a lot bigger share than my sisters did, of course. Also answering phones, waiting on tables, and when I got my license, delivering pizzas. Well, I digress a little bit. The point of that was to let you know that I know a lot about dough. In running a pizza restaurant, we used to mix dough in large batches. For a 25-pound bag of flour, we would put in about 2 tablespoons of yeast, a lot of water, obviously, and then the secret ingredients that I can't tell you about. Not because I am bound by some kind of non-disclosure clause, but because I really don't remember anymore. But after we mixed that dough, we would put it into a 10-gallon bucket. 10-gallon bucket. That's about the same amount of dough that the woman in the parable made. And let me tell you, that is a lot of dough. That little bit of yeast, that little bit was enough to make the crust rise on a few dozen pizzas for that day. And we would have to punch down the dough several times as it doubled and tripled in size so that it wouldn't overflow the container. It's truly amazing. And Jesus tells us that's what the kingdom of God is like. That little mustard seed that grows into a large plant, or that little bit of yeast that makes that huge amount of dough to rise. Remember that the kingdom of God is the gracious rule and reign of God. It is God's activity. God doing God's thing here on earth as it is done in heaven. And God's work in the world is often hard to see, especially in a world that's full of violence and wickedness. We are rightly horrified by the moral chaos of postmodern America. a immorality or even amorality that is tearing apart families, dividing communities and churches. God hates sin, and that stuff makes him sad and angry. Of course, we need to remind ourselves, too, that God hates our sin as well, and not just the sin of those people over there. But the moral foundations of our society are shaken, and the church no longer enjoys its place of privileged position in public discourse. America is a lot like Israel during the time of the judges, when there was no king in Israel and everyone did what was right in his own eyes. And we look at our broken society, faltering church attendance in North America and in Europe, and we wonder, why does God allow the wicked to prosper? The parables of Jesus urge us to have hope and to have patience. They remind us that big things come from small beginnings. The kingdom of God began with Jesus, just one person, an army of one. And then it grew to 4 disciples, and then 12, and then the 120 that were gathered on the day of Pentecost. And then from there, hundreds, and then thousands, as it continued to grow. Despite persecution, Christianity grew. Tertullian in the 2nd century famously wrote that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church, by which he meant that the more that the religious persecution and the government persecution of Christianity hit against it, the more that it would respond by God's grace to grow and flourish. Not until the Edict of Milan in 317 AD, when the Emperor Constantine legalized Christianity, and he himself became a Christian, did Christianity become the biggest influencer of the culture and begin to enjoy this privileged position. That lasted for about 1,500 years until the era of the Enlightenment during the mid-1700s. And since then, the Western Church has grown more liberal. There seems to be this great apostasy, this great falling away. In Europe, people say that maybe 10% of the population goes to church. Nowadays, here in America, it's about a quarter of the population. And we especially see that with the younger generation, people are not going to church as much anymore. And yet the church continues to grow exponentially in Africa, in Asia, in South America, because a little leaven, a little bit of yeast, can leaven the entire lump. Even those 13 siyas, or 39 liters, or 10 gallons of dough. Everywhere you look, we can still see the hand of God's work in the world. Hospitals, universities are the legacy of the church. And even though many of them are now corporate owned, many hospitals still bear names that mark their Christian origins. They have the names of denominations or Christian saints. There's Lutheran Hospital in Lakewood and St. Joseph Hospital in Denver, because they were founded in the imitation of the mercy ministry of Jesus, his healing ministry. Did you know that in the ancient world, there were no hospitals? When people would get sick among the pagans, they would eventually just get afraid and throw them out in the streets and leave them to die of exposure because they were worried about getting sick themselves. When plague hit the city of Rome in the 200s, it was Christians who stayed behind to nurse their sick and dying neighbors while the wealthy fled to their suburban retreats in the country. And the saying that started to go around about the believers was, "See how they love one another." And God's hand was evident in that. Universities and schools have been founded by the church because there was a recognition that in order to teach and learn the scriptures, there needed to be an educated clergy and an educated laity. And so they founded universities where they would study rhetoric and grammar and the Bible and theology. And then from there, eventually other disciplines, the sciences, the arts, they were added. But universities, again, they're a cultural heritage of the work of the church. Most of the great works of literature, music, and the arts were made by Christians or inspired by the Christian story until the Enlightenment in the 1700s. And, of course, also many of just the maxims, the little proverbs and sayings that we have in English come straight out of the King James Bible. Wherever Christianity has gone in the world, it has added human dignity. It has raised the value of women and children from being seen as just property to being actual human beings with rights and with importance before God. And Jesus says, whatever you did for the least of these, you did for me. Even the founding principles of our democracy in this country are not just based on Greek democracy, as maybe your public school textbook would have you believe, but they're also based on the Christian principle of freedom. Paul writes that for freedom, Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. And so the spiritual freedom that we have in Christ led to a recognition of a need for a political and social freedom as well. All of that flowing out of the gospel and the truth of God's word. Truly, the world is a better place because of Christ and his kingdom operating through the mission and the ministry of the church through the centuries. And even if the church suffered persecution in its beginnings, and even if the church is suffering persecution now in this time and age, no matter how many times people threaten us and try to punch down the dough, so to speak, to keep it from rising, it's going to keep rising anyway as the church continues to grow. The most amazing evidence of God's work in the world, however, is not all of these wonderful things that we, the people of God, have done, but it is what God has done for us. It is the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The same Jesus that told so many stories about seeds. The sower that scattered the seed on the four different kinds of ground. The sower that planted good seed in his field and his enemy planted the bad seed. The one that went out and planted that mustard seed in the garden. Jesus also compared his own body to a seed. And he said that in John's gospel that unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. And Jesus' body on the cross was that seed for our salvation, which died, was buried in the ground like a seed for 3 days. And yet the dust of death could not destroy it. 3 days later, Jesus rose from the dead, giving life and salvation to all who believe in his name. That's the abundant fruit that he was talking about, so that the seed of his body would not remain alone, but would grow as others came to believe and trust in him. These parables of Jesus prove that God is at work in the world, even when his hand is hard to see. Like a tiny mustard seed or that little bit of yeast, God's kingdom starts small, but it grows large. It gets big because big things come from small beginnings. And the parables of Jesus also demonstrate that God works through simple, ordinary people and things. The reign of heaven is like a farmer who went out to sow. Like a mustard seed, like a woman baking bread, like a man who stumbles upon treasure, like a net full of fish. The kingdom of God, Jesus says, is at hand. The kingdom of God is among you. It is in you. It is with you in the ordinary people and the ordinary everyday parts of our life. As Barbara Brown Taylor writes, the kingdom of heaven is mixed in with the humdrum and the ho-hum of our days and all the ordinary people and places and activities. God still works through small, simple, ordinary things to accomplish his mighty will in our lives. Through the word and sacraments, his means of grace, he forgives our sins and gives us eternal life. He uses, through simple stories of ordinary men, women, and children in the Bible, to create faith in our hearts. He uses the water of holy baptism and the bread and wine in the Lord's Supper. And God takes what is small, what is simple, even what might be despised in the world, and he transforms it into the life-giving Word of God, into a fountain of youth and into the very body and blood of Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins. And all that it takes is the faith of a mustard seed to believe it and receive it. And yet even that tiny mustard seed in your heart can grow into a towering plant with perches for the birds of heaven. Whoever has ears to hear, let them hear. In the name of Jesus, amen.